Thank you all very much, and thank you, Dr. Sell and Mike, for inviting me to speak here. Can you all hear me in the far back tents? Yes, raise your hand if you can hear. Awesome. All right, everybody, thank you for coming out on this cold, blustery morning. A little bit about me, because I get asked to speak. People just kind of come up to me and say and do all kinds of crazy things. One person even just grabbed my hair once, and she said, "You still have your hair." And I'm going like, okay, I'm 64. Am I not supposed to? But, you know, running on a plant-based diet is the best kept secret in America. But I think the word is finally getting out because people like me are running around the country and talking about all of this. And just as far as my background goes, well, you can see the books that I have up here. And I spent 18 years in TV news. And this was me in 1983. It was the year I almost died of a colon blockage. 28 years old, was working really hard, as I always did in news, and we had a snowstorm. We got trapped at the TV station, and they catered it with cold cuts, high salt meat, and I wasn't drinking enough water, and I doubled over in the bathroom, and they had to rush me to the ER, and the doctor said, "We've never seen a colon blockage this large in somebody so young, and you need to be on drugs the rest of your life." And it was the same year my sister got breast cancer for the second time, and I thought, whoa, I am way too young to be on medicine for the rest of my life. So I ran to the health food store and read all 5 books on fiber, because that's all there was at the time. And I went, my progression was macrobiotic, which is kind of like a vegan diet, except it allows for white fish and very restrictive. You can only eat in your latitude. So living in St. Louis, I couldn't eat oranges. You know, things like that that just didn't work really well for a busy TV reporter. And in that picture, you can see that in the background there are the beans and the grains. And then I eventually went vegetarian and then made the progression to vegan. But for most of us, it's not a straight line. I had 3 children, and I'll tell you, the colon blockage was way more painful than natural childbirth 3 times. So you don't want to get that constipated, okay? Keep eating the fiber and keep drinking the water, and the Roto-Rooter man won't need to come. And it was amazing, the change. It really happened within days once I started increasing fiber into my diet. And being in television, it wasn't an easy job convincing people, but it is amazing now, being on Facebook, how many people I have heard from that I used to work with, and they're going like, wow, you don't look any different than you did in the 1980s. And again, I think a plant-based diet and running is just completely magical. I'm just curious, how many of you are vegetarian? We asked this at the race this morning. Keep your hands up if you're vegan. Okay, awesome. So preaching a little bit to the choir here. And for the rest of you who are here, no judgment zone at all, but look around at those hands that were up and be sure you start talking to one of those people and ask them how they're loving their plant-based lifestyle. All right, so with 3 children, I became a Leche League leader. How many of you are familiar with that organization, Breastfeeding Information and Support? You know, that whole species-specific milk thing? You know, our culture doesn't do a great job of promoting breastfeeding for lots of different reasons, but because of my family history of breast cancer, we became part of the original Myriad Genetics breast cancer gene studies. And with my mom and both sisters having breast cancer, doctors were telling me from a very early age, you better do some things differently or you're going to end up like everybody else. I grew up in hospitals watching friends and especially my relatives get very sick and sometimes die. And my best friend actually died of breast cancer. And the last thing she said on her deathbed was, "Take care of my kids." Well, she had a great husband, he took care of the kids fine, but my work really is why I do these kinds of things, just because I've seen so much pain and needless, and I believe preventable suffering, that we need to get the message out there because there is no money in broccoli. My progression after leaving television is I went and spent 5 years working as a financial consultant for Smith Barney in St. Louis. I was the number one market performer, and I specialized in socially responsible investing, which meant avoiding tobacco, alcohol, and firearms. And for those clients who wanted it, the animal screen. They didn't want to buy Procter & Gamble because it tested on animals. So that's what I did. I was kind of known as Earth Mother in a Suit, and Walking Magazine did the cover story with me and my three girls then. But even during my breastfeeding days, we were still told once the babies were theoretically weaned, Leche League, and doctors and nurses and everybody else was saying, well, you gotta be drinking dairy. And all this time I'm thinking, like, we're the only species that drinks milk from another species. Why, when our babies are weaned, in theory, do we start drinking milk from another species? So that really set in motion my journey to become vegan more extensively than even I was just at that time. When I worked at Smith Barney, the only problem there was computers were just getting hot and heavy, and we had working lunches and dinners at Morton's with our clients put on by the company, and the only choice I got for lunch was what topping I wanted on my pizza. So I went off a vegan diet then. You know, I tried to keep the McDougal cups under my desk, but one cannot live on McDougal cups alone. And I put on 30 pounds. And here in this picture, I was about 145 pounds. So then we moved to Florida, and within 6 months I had hemorrhaging fibroid tumors, went to the ER for the second time in my life, and the doctors said, oh, we gotta do a hysterectomy. And my regular OB got on the phone, turns out she's a closet vegan, and she goes, Ellen, go back to that vegan diet and call me in the morning. 3 weeks later, all signs of menopause were gone, including the hot flashes, didn't need the hysterectomy, the fibroid shrank, and that was my entry fully into menopause. How many hysterectomies could we save in this country if we had courageous doctors who said, go on a vegan diet and call me in the morning? Again, I'm percolating this idea about how do I get this message out. So I started, I didn't realize that not everybody does this, but every year I get a physical and I would save the results. And this shows back in the year 2000 when I was at Smith Barney and my cholesterol, I was eating all that high protein diets, trying to keep my weight under control, but not doing it very well, trying to survive at Morton's. So my cholesterol was 203 at the top of it. And it stayed up there for several years until finally I moved to Florida and got a little serious about what was going on at that point. And you can see that I even had fibroids as well as coronary calcification of my arteries in my heart. So that was really a wake-up call. Once I returned to a low-fat vegan diet, cholesterol is back down to the 150s and it lives in the 140s again today. You know, every couple of years or so, I go and get my blood work done from my doctor and they'll call me back with the results, and you know, I just try to annoy them a little bit and I go, so what are the results? And they say, yeah, you know, remind me again, what are you on? Lipitor, right? And I go, no, I'm on plants. And again, we have to be very much an activist with our medical community to let them know how well this is working. But my biggest success was not myself. I started doing media consulting after I left television, and the first person I called up was Dr. Neil Barnard, who is still president of Physicians Committee for Responsible Medicine. How many of you have heard of that very fine, wonderful organization? Dr. Barnard is such a hero, so modest, and you know, he's just always out there putting the message both for our own health as well as the health of animals. So I was doing media training, smelled my way into their kitchen, and they were developing a program called the Cancer Project. And I began to inquire about that, got their training, and became one of their instructors. And at the time when it was completely grant-funded, I was doing two classes a day, 60 people at the Anna Maria Island Community Center, and doing that 5 days a week. And my biggest success was Corky Carlson. That's her before and after picture. And she's given permission to tell her story, but she lost 120 pounds in 8 months, never counting a single calorie, just loving the recipes in the Cancer Project cookbook. And it was her experience. They gave her up for dead when she came to my class. She had been diagnosed with multiple myeloma, one of the more fatal forms of bone cancer. She's still messaging me on Facebook today. That was 12 years ago. So pretty amazing that people do go through these changes, and amazing, amazing changes. So finally, my book has percolated in my head after all these years. Eat Vegan on $4 a Day, that was my my first child. Every single recipe in that book has an estimated price based on ingredients you can find at any big box store. And people go, ew, are you recommending Walmart? And I'm going, ew, if you live below the poverty level of $23,000 for a family of four, you're already shopping at Walmart. I wanted to show that you can eat a healthy plant-based diet without going to a health food store. These are ingredients that are commonly available. I developed those recipes when I was a single working mom, and all I wanted to do was come home at the end of the day and get food on the table in a hurry for my three daughters. And as you can see, the price of beans just hasn't gone up very much. I like to say since 2011 when I wrote the book, but people have stood up in my audiences and said, you know, I remember when beans were just a nickel an ounce when you buy them in bulk 30 years ago. Compared to meat and dairy, the prices have gone through the roof. And again, it's because we are stretching the limits to the amount of land that is available for agriculture, which most of the corn in this country is grown for animals. This was a real wake-up call for me. My first job was in Des Moines, Iowa, WHO-TV, Ronald Reagan's old station, and we used to go up to the top of grain elevators with a photographer, and his thing was to throw the switch in the middle of the elevator ride, and I would scream, and the sound would just reverberate all down through the grain elevator. So those are the kinds of things we did for fun. But at the top of the grain elevator, we would take pictures, and I would do my reporting holding the microphone, terrified of heights, daring not to look down. But when I did look down, you could see stockpiles of corn for as far as the eye could see. And all that corn, I never realized what it was going for until I interviewed a farmer once, and I said, this farmer was, we were doing a story on him using the land not only for corn, but also for soybeans, and I said, well, when they use the land for both, does it make any difference in the taste of the soybeans? And he goes, ma'am, you'd have to ask the cows, because our corn is grown for cows. City girl from St. Louis. All right, so paleo, oh my gosh, paleo. Make my head explode. Okay, so I started running when I moved to Florida. Again, I'd always been a runner, but I never started placing, because as I like to joke, sometimes placing in my age group is just about showing up. Although, folks who are about to retire or who have reached retirement age are very much looking for things to do, and running becomes one of them. So my age group is, as much to my surprise, quite competitive. And I have done all the high protein diets, Atkins, South Beach, Zone, just to name a few. And when paleo came out, I forced myself to read the meat-based paleo books because some of my running friends were talking about this 5 or 6 years ago. And then I started hearing some vegans saying they were going paleo and, oh, we've lost so much weight. And so I thought, somebody's got to look at this from the vegan perspective. Because I thought, you know, what are the odds that a wild boar was running through our backyard 3 times a day during Paleolithic times? And sure enough, after I wrote this book, National Geographic, within the year, had a cover story called The Real Paleo Diet. And they said, we were way more gatherers than we were hunters. And they quoted my book in about a dozen different places, not by attribution, but definitely by concept. And again, if they were lucky to catch back in true Paleolithic times a wild boar every 2 weeks and then cook it without, or prepare it in a way that they didn't get sick and die after eating it, it was a miracle. So that's paleo vegan. And there is the cover story called The Real Paleo Diet from the National Geographic magazine. All right, so with the running, I started doing 5Ks, and you know, it took me a year before I had enough guts to actually go to the Bradenton Runners Club and show up for a training run. And people were very supportive, and how many of you are runners? A few of you, okay, awesome, awesome. So I really hate running, I just wanted to mention that. And I thought, well, if I can wear this vegan shirt at a race, how cool would that be? And sure enough, when I started placing, and this is, by the way, the third place age group award from this morning, and this was just everybody over 60, this wasn't just the 5-year increments. So I thought, you know, people will come up to me and maybe talk to me, and they would come up, but they'd look at my shirt and they'd go, oh, you can't race on a vegan diet, or you can't run on a vegan diet. So every single race I do, and I've placed in, as of this morning, 109, but believe me, I've competed in twice that many because I don't always place. But I always use the opportunity wearing my vegan shirt, and now those of you who have run this morning, you have the wonderful plant-powered 5K shirt, at least wear that to your next race, and get to talking to people about this, because again, it is the best kept secret. So I also discovered the local senior games, and I didn't even know anything about this. I mean, they do everything at the national senior games, including pickleball. When I competed in the national senior games a couple of years, 4 years ago, that was my first time, the whole plane from Tampa was filled with pickleball people. So find a way to get involved, find your sport, they do everything. So back in 2012, I got, let's see, at the local level, oops, what happened there? Do we know how to get it back full screen? Thanks, Mike. I think I pressed the wrong button. I don't want to press any more buttons. Yeah. So that was 2012 with 3 third place medals. That got me to go to state. In 2014, I was actually first in state in everything in Florida for my age group, 50 meters, 100, 200, 400, 800, and 1500 meters. And yeah, so if you can just click on either one of those will work, get us back to full screen. And yeah, we're working on it. So that is the National Senior Games, that picture on the left. I assume you're seeing that where I'm on the end. I placed 7th in the U.S. in my age group in the 1500 meters, 10th in the 400, 16th in the 200, and 19th in the 100 meters. So that was really just by being a weekend athlete also, which was pretty amazing. Some of these women I would meet at the national level, you know, they would be training all year long with their trainers at USC, and then they would pay for their trainers to come with them to Cleveland where the National Senior Games were being held. So that was a pretty interesting experience just to see the level of competition and devotion that some of the people at my age have. Well, so I pressed something on there. Maybe you can unpress it. Technology is just great when it works. All right. Yeah. Well, the next slide, if you could see it, would be showing, yeah, there we go. That one, are you all able to see the 62 at the top, or is there nothing showing at all? No signal. Oh. You got that one. All right. So we're seeing the ones, you see the one, the 62? Perfect.
Yep, we're there, all right.
For now, okay. So after the National Senior Games that I competed in 4 years ago, they sent out a survey, we had to answer some questions, and then I get this back, it says, your chronological age is 62, I guess this was from 2 years ago, and your athletic age is 26, so I thought that was kind of fun. And there are the first place medals from the state senior games. And by the way, this is the one that I got this year, several, one of several. I placed this year, just a couple of months ago, in the 1500 meters, first in the 15 and first in the 800 and then the 4x1 relay. So that qualifies me for nationals again this summer. So I'm now working with a personal trainer who was a Navy SEAL, and we'll see if I survive that. So there we started in 2014, 71 times I've placed in my age group. That was the wall last year, 2 years ago, 2016, and then finally just had to buy a new house. Get a new wall. Actually, my boyfriend did that. He's amazing with construction. So that was just a couple of times, a couple of weeks ago, to 107 times. All right, what I want to show you now is my marathon body, because this is, we're really getting into some of the subtleties of training on a vegan diet. The reason I wrote Vegan Fitness for Mortals is because, first of all, not a whole lot of women are out there on the lecture circuit who are vegan athletes and a certified personal trainer talking about these kinds of concepts. I mean, even just the way we warmed up this morning, it's very important to do it correctly, or you will end up possibly with injuries. So very lean here in my marathon body. Those are my marathon biceps. Not a whole lot of body fat or bulk. But here we go, having trained for the National Senior Games, and because it's more explosive and sprinting and interval training, same diet, different body. Exhausting work. All right, just ask all the animals on the planet, the largest ones, where they get their protein, and of course, it's the same place vegans are getting their protein. And this is probably my favorite slide of all. How many of you follow Vegan Street? It's a great website. You need to be on it. Yeah, Marla Rose out of Chicago, they put on Chicago's Vegan Mania, great event. They come up with all these incredible memes that just tell the story like no other. I mean, why are we drinking milk from another species? It makes no sense. You know, I actually did some research for Paleo Vegan and found out why we started drinking milk in the first place. It was in the middle of the desert. They ran out of water and they had some animals that looked like they were secreting a little bit. So that's how that all came about, you know, roughly 5,000, 6,000, 7,000 years ago. All right, this vegan isn't remotely concerned about his protein. And in case you ever get the question, you can go on Vegan Street and order all kinds of t-shirts, including this one, and so people can just stare at your shirt when you're racing and they can, you don't even have to answer the question, where do you get your protein? And just, again, other memes there that just tell the story. Where do we get it? Beans, nuts, and seeds, and of course, all plants have some protein. Yes, we love to eat in color. I always tell people, eat the colors of the rainbow, as opposed to the animal kingdom, which is pretty much brown, brown, and brown. And if you barbecue it, it's black, black, and black, and that'll give you cancer. All right, so this slide just talks about how difficult it is to be on a vegan diet. Really, no. It's so much easier to go plant-based, go vegan, and avoid the $100,000 bypass surgery. How many of you have ever been told a vegan diet is so complicated? Yeah, no. Let me tell you what's complicated. So my ex-husband had a heart attack, and he had it in my presence, and I drove him to the hospital. And he did not eat the way I did, he did not exercise. And without going there too much, we'll just say he spent a month in cardiac rehab. And that little visit, we asked the nurses, how much would it have cost if Medicare hadn't paid for it? $1 million for 30 days at Blake Hospital up in Bradenton for cardiac rehab. Heart disease is not sustainable. It isn't. We can't keep paying for this, no matter if it's an insurance company, if it's us individually, if it's a corporation, we have to figure this out. And by the way, he woke up from surgery and said, I never want to have this pain again, help me go vegan. It lasted a month. And again, without going there, it just didn't work. So I want people to think about the $1,000 burger. People say, you know, it's my choice what I get to eat. But when you go and order a $5 hamburger at a restaurant, and you dollar cost average, going into my financial services brain here, the cost of a bypass surgery at $100,000, which is what it's estimated at and on a lot of websites, and divide that over the number of hamburgers you eat in your lifetime, it really is a $500 or $1,000 hamburger. So I hope people think about that and how much obesity kills worldwide. We're all paying for it. And our choices affects all of the diseases that we have. My sisters who had breast cancer, the family members who had breast cancer, they all had heart disease and diabetes. And there were 4 major cases of Alzheimer's tied in. Dr. Neil Barnard has written about all of these different diseases and how they're tied in to our arteries getting clogged up in all parts of the body. How many of you heard Dr. Khan right before me speak? Well, yes, he publicly announced that our little casual conversation on the parking lot is going to result in our next book. We're trying to squeeze it in. Both of us are under contract to write books with publishers. My next one will be Vegan for One, out in summer of 2017. And he's got another book, but we're gonna try and self-publish this next one, Vegan Sex. Because it's all about blood flow. I tried to sell this one to my publisher and they said, well, you know, we really want the medical interpretation of it. And I'm going like, no, you don't. You want a firsthand experienced person who's been with non-vegans for all of my life. And once, I mean, without going there too much, I mean, like, OMG, I'm just gonna say that. Okay, and you'll have to read the book. Okay, so if you are running, and because it's a family audience, I don't wanna say too much, but if you are running, wear that vegan shirt, get out there, and what's kind of fun too is that when you compete at bigger races and they have age group awards, the 5-year increments, we were doing a little bit of this morning, you know, you take pictures with everybody, and of course, all those non-vegans in that picture, the first and second and other age group award winners, are gonna be having their families look at these pictures and go, wow, there's a vegan who's running in that, and she placed. And what's really fascinating is that every race I do, I'm seeing people, women, who used to beat me 10, 15 years ago, they're not there anymore. They've got arthritis. And that's the cool thing about a vegan diet. It's not 100% guarantee, but the inflammation level is incredibly low or non-existent. And us vegans are not getting arthritis. So the ones who were beating me 10 years ago, they've got arthritis of the hips, the knees, and they're just complaining about their aches and pains. And same thing at the National Senior Games when I competed. The reason I did so well in the 1500 meters, it was on day 3. Day 1, we did the 100 and the 200 meters. Day 2 was the 800 and the 400. And then by day 3, when the 1500 meters was, I was hearing women at the check-in table saying, oh, I got a scratch today, I can't run, I'm too sore. It was a little sore, but certainly not enough to not run. So again, great secret, you know? And of course, get your picture when you place in the age group with the most ridiculous people there, because these pictures will end up all over Facebook. All right, how many of you follow me on Facebook? A few of you, awesome. I tell people if you buy any of my books, you get a lifetime access to me on Facebook. My first book, Eat Vegan, was turned down for an entire year because the publishers, my agent told me, all they cared about was how many friends you have on Facebook and how many tweets a day you tweet. So I had to learn all this stuff, kicking and screaming, but very important. And of course, finally, if you've seen my car in the parking lot here, it's the Vegan Mobile. Instaprint gives you the largest magnet there. I think they're about $15, something like that. So just be a walking billboard as much as you can tolerate for yourself. And so far nobody has slashed my tires, so I think we're good. And even to the license plate, of course, my website, vegcoach.com. Okay, those are my most fun resources. Vegan bodybuilding, anytime people ask me the protein question, I send them to veganbodybuilding.com. Robert Cheek, who's also an author with my publisher, wrote the book called Vegan Bodybuilding. And if you go on his website, you see all these guys and gals who look like they've been on steroids for years, but they've just been on plants. So check it out. And localharvest.org. How many of you belong to a CSA? Community Supported Agriculture Farm. Excellent, excellent. So a lot of times you can get produce ridiculously cheap there. For me, when I did it back in the days when I had time, $15 to $20 a week, mostly organic. They may or may not have the organic certification because that's a whole can of worms. And expensive, and they don't want to pass that along to you. But I volunteered there, so I saw they were getting their seeds from the next link there, Seeds of Change, non-GMO seeds, organic, hybrid seeds, all that kind of good stuff. And if you volunteer at one of these farms, whether it's a CSA or just a plain old co-op, you often can get great reductions on the prices of the food, and sometimes, some cases, if you do a work share, you can get the food for free. So how cool is that? If you don't want to like grow the stuff yourself, Purcell Mountains has some great organic beans. And then my doctor friends, Dr. McDougall, PCRM.org, NutritionMD. How many of you are following Dr. Michael Greger? If I had to recommend one site, one video, a group of videos, his is it. 2 to 3 minute nuggets of really great, usually very funny information, but 100% accurate. So he's on the national circuit as well. And then finally, just Facebook, I am the admin of, I think it's up to 13 pages now. I finally hired somebody to try and bring it in for me and narrow it down. But the Vegan Mythbusters radio show is something I have been doing. It's kind of morphed into different places. Dr. Don is a doctor out of Lake Havasu, Arizona, and he has the Dr. Don show every single day, weekday at 3:30 Eastern time, and so you can check out his show. But he has guest hosts, and I'm on once a week with the Vegan Mythbusters show, where we try and bust every single vegan myth out there, not all in one show, but hopefully to get people interested enough. And for me, it is about marketing, and it is about finding what reaches people. I was a speaker at the Miami Book Fair a couple years ago, and a guy breezes through the table, and he kind of does this double take as he turns back and looks at the table, and he goes, "Well, I don't know about vegan, but you had me at $4 a day." So finding what touches people. Of course, I often say that the reason we have so many young people who are vegan is because they grew up in the YouTube generation. All these videos are out there now telling us and showing us how animals are being treated. And even though the very first thing that got me interested was a film back in the 1980s about how Ringling was treating its elephants, look how long it took us to get there. Ringling is no more with the circuses. So, yeah. So that's where we're going. A lot of people on social media are saying SeaWorld is next. We'll see. Stay tuned. Stay tuned. But I think we're recognizing how barbaric it is to bring animals out from the wild when we can go out with our smartphones and record them in all angles and see them much better than we could at a zoo or someplace like that. So that's a whole other topic, but all these dots are so connected, and it's very hard to stick our heads in the mud, in the sand, and pretend that we don't see anymore, because the reality is in front of our faces. How many of you have seen the very brief 7-minute video called Dairy is Scary? Google it, and if you're still consuming dairy after that, give me a call, we'll talk. Again, lots of great videos out there that you can check out. How are we doing on time, Mike?
10 minutes.
Okay, why don't we open up to questions? Just scream out your question, and I will try and answer it as best I can. I'm going to stay around after my talk. I've got a few books up here. My table is all the way in just straight back, so you can find me back there if I run out of books here, and I'll just be in the back with my books because I think we have another speaker coming in. So, questions, please. Yes, ma'am. Scream it out. How do you influence people who are members of your family who are not vegan? Is that basically the question? Okay. Well, that's why I wrote Kitchen Divided. In that book, there are recipes that you can make for yourself. The idea was to streamline the cooking process. So the recipes are your main course, their side dish, or a main course for both of you, and they can dump in whatever meat or fish or whatever they want to put in. So, and then there are dishes in there that I try to replicate, veganize from like places like Carrabba's and Red Lobster, things that meat eaters or, you know, carnivores would like. But if you could veganize it and make it look like one of their comfort foods, maybe it would bring them into the fold. You know, I really think that food is the way, you know, just keep trying. And I think one of the reasons I became a cookbook author is because I did exactly that. I had just hundreds of books with tabs in them, trying different recipes, trying to please everybody. You know, I'm a third daughter, so I'm always trying to please. And spoiler alert, it doesn't work. But, you know, all you can do is keep trying to make beautiful, colorful dishes, and I spare no expense when it comes to investing in a high-powered blender, because smoothies and ice creams that are vegan, that are still very healthy, and sneak in those greens whenever you can, that's a way to bring them into the fold. You know, that one slide I had comparing the colors of the rainbow, which are predominant in the plant kingdom, but not the animal kingdom. When you make a salad that is so vibrant and rich in colors, that often appeals to people. And serve it outside if you can, if the weather cooperates, because the sunlight will really make the colors pop. So sometimes, you know, it's funny, we went to lunch yesterday with a couple who was not at all vegan, and we went to some fish place or something, and they're stressing about what can you order, and I said, I can always get a salad, I'm not gonna starve until the next meal. And they go, well, what are you gonna order, just lettuce? I mean, people have no idea. So just educate, use, you know, family get-togethers. For me, I was, you know, I was called a black sheep. Anybody get that black sheep label yet? So, cult member, guilty, I'm proud of it, and I'm having the last laugh, sadly. So, you know, you just do what you can. As I say in Kitchen Divided, you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make it drink. And just be that example, be the change you want to see. And people are watching us. You know, as Dr. Khan said, you know, not that Dr. Oz is the great medical doctor of all time, but is veganism, a vegan diet, the diet of the year? It's the diet of the century. And because of what's happening with the environment, read the work of Dr. Richard Oppenlander, who wrote the book Comfortably Unaware. I heard him speak at Vegetarian Summerfest, which is another thing you should go to, Johnstown, Pennsylvania, summer camp for vegans. And it's a whole week with national speakers, and it's on a college campus in the foothills of the Allegheny Mountains, and just a wonderful community and place to be. But he talked about we should have been vegan yesterday to save this planet. So to the extent that we need to be there, I think it's going to happen sooner or later. And I always say, I hope you like the recipes in my cookbook, because we're all going to be vegan sooner or later, whether we want to or not. The planet just can't sustain a population of 9 billion or more people on a meat and dairy diet. And that's one of the quotes, by the way, out of National Geographic, that cover story, which it's huge to see mainstream publications and institutions embracing a vegan diet, because anybody who believes in science really sees what is in store for us. All right, other questions? And Mike, just give me the cue when I need, because my watch is not talking to me. When we need to be out of here. Next question. Yes, ma'am.
I don't eat vegetables. I just don't have a taste for them.
Speak up. I don't eat any vegetables, she says.
I don't eat vegetables. I wish I did, but I just don't have a taste.
Don't like vegetables. Okay.
Doesn't have a taste for them.
What are your options? Okay, fruits, beans, nuts. But I would also say join a CSA, or at least look at some of their vegetables that they grow, because, for example, who likes beet greens? Anybody? Do we have any beet greens? Oh, wow, okay. Well, shoots down that idea. Some people really hate beet greens, and at my CSA, they had a variety of beet greens that was called candy cane beets. It had a beautiful white and red variegated color, and I tasted both the beets and the greens and went back to the CSA next week and asked the farmer, what's the deal with these? They taste really salty and really sweet and delicious, and he goes, it's just the variety. So sometimes you might find a vegetable that you don't like and maybe try another one. I mean, there are hundreds of different vegetables out there. So joining a CSA may expose you to ones that are fresher and different from what you've been tasting in the grocery store. So that's an idea. But beans, nuts and seeds, and some fruits. I mean, there are fruitarians out there. It's not a diet that I would recommend for an athlete, but you know, maybe just something to transition. It's really important to eat foods in their natural states too, as much as you can. There are lots of good faux meats out there now, and the companies are seeing the dollar signs, so you certainly can binge on those for a while you're transitioning, but really try. I always ask my clients as a personal trainer, what did Mother Nature intend? What did our ancestors really do? And that's kind of how we ought to be designing our diets, I think. So I hope that was helpful. Just, you know, put sugar on it or something. I mean, do something. Just eat those vegetables. Eat your vegetables! All right, I do understand your pain. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am. Second row here, black. If somebody loves coffee or tea, what do they do for a creamer? There are so many non-dairy ones out there and so many non-dairy plant-based milks. I took a picture and posted it on Facebook a few weeks ago. The non-dairy milks are overtaking the cow's milk at the grocery stores now. It is so exciting to see that. Oh, you know, there is hemp milk. Don't smoke it. There is oat milk, there is almond milk, rice milk. You know, try them. They're cheap enough. You try them. If you hate them, you can always move on to another. A lot of people like almond milk in their coffee. So Starbucks even has coconut milk, I think, or almond milk. You just ask them, they've got it. It's just going so mainstream now. So there are all these different plant-based milks you can try. Yes?
Kefir
is dairy, though. Kefir's dairy. Yeah, that's dairy based. So, yeah. So, yeah, but there's all these books out there, again, the antithesis of a vegan diet. Wheat belly, brain, with grain brain, you know, oh my God, your brain's exploding from grain. Your brain is exploding from grain. You know, as I talk about in Paleo Vegan, we were way more plant eaters than we were hunters. And, you know, the odds of catching an animal are just so minimal. So, again, it's all about marketing, and there's no money in broccoli. When you understand that there's no money in broccoli, there's no broccoli association, no broccoli corporation, same thing for breast milk, that's really where I got the idea. Then you understand why you have to be your own investigative reporter and figure out the truth about food. So just try different things. Yes, ma'am, in the scarf. Scream really loud. I can't hear you. Organic soy protein. Okay. So again, it doesn't totally fit my model of what did our ancestors really eat and what did Mother Nature intend. Were they stomping on olives and squeezing out the oil? Were they extracting protein from protein in its natural sources? No. But if it's something that makes you feel more satisfied or less craving, then once in a while, it's probably going to be fine. As far as soy itself, try and get non-GMO. But as my Asian cookbook author friends, Miyoko Skinner, who wrote the book Artisan Vegan Cheese, also with my publisher, her head explodes. She does 5Ks and places in her age group, and she's an amazing fit, 70-something. And she says, look, the Asian culture has been consuming soy forever, and our breast cancer rates are way less than what they are in the U.S. So what else is it that we're doing that's causing cancer? You know, it's one of those questions that's very hard to answer. But trying to stick as close to nature as you can, it's not always possible. Some of my friends who sold vegan proteins are not doing that anymore because they realize and understand that we ought to be promoting the foods more than the product. So looking at follow the money and what is the real message there, that's what we're trying to get at. All right, other questions? Yes, sir. Decent substitute for eggs. I hear that veg is very good. I don't live close to a health food store. So, and also another cool thing, I do Facebook Lives every Wednesday at 3 p.m. Eastern. Fresh Market donates $150 worth of free food for me to do cooking demos for an hour and do a Facebook Live. I used to do actual cooking classes, and then I figured out, hey, instead of taking 2 days of my life to do this, I can do it in one by just doing it online. And we get hundreds of people watching. So what's cool is that they don't pay for advertising. But when I walked in there about 3 years ago and said, oh, I'm this cookbook author, they said, you are just what we're looking for, because they knew that I would have a platform. So there are all these different ways that you can get the message out there, and especially with being on social media, I encourage all of you to find your voice, find whatever passion it is that you have to get out there and spread your message however it is. So maybe other people have ideas about vegan eggs, but You know, it just hasn't been anything I've really wanted to pay the money for to substitute. Also, Fresh Market, I'm getting the hands down from the front row up here, no good substitutes. You know, Fresh Market still needs to expand their vegan line. I think Publix is doing a very good job of carrying more vegan foods. Maybe the rest of you have other ideas about that. Any other questions floating around? Okay, I think we will wrap it up. I will be up here with, I'll be in the back with my books until the next speaker starts speaking, and then I'll be at the table. There's no tent, that's how you can find me, and I got a really obnoxious sign out there with my name on it. So thank you all very much for coming. Go Plants!
Thank you, Ellen, that was wonderful. Thank you so much. Anybody have pets? Anybody have dogs, cats, other pets? You absolutely want to be here in the next 15 minutes. Andrew Kirshner is going to talk about animals and the planet and some really cool stuff, so don't miss the next lecture. So be back by 12 o'clock and we'll be ready to go.